Hello and welcome to Atop the Fourth Wall, where bad comics burn. And welcome once again to Secret Origins Month. Awesome new logo by ZeroRyoko999. Good guy, screw you, content ID. So let's talk about the original Marvel superhero, the Human Torch. Unfortunately, like so many other characters, there's not much information about why the Human Torch was created, the inspirations and whatnot. But to talk about the Human Torch, we need to talk about his creator, Carl Burgos. Like many artists and writers of the time, he was employed by a studio to provide material for comic magazines, including, of course, what would become Marvel Comics number one, as I talked a bit about last year. Yep, of course, we're following up on last year's review. Burgos was a very private man who, as far as I know, only gave one interview in his life. Most of what we know about him comes from his daughter, and his legal case. In the 60s, he attempted to get back the rights to the Human Torch from Marvel, along with creating a character called Captain Marvel. Yes, there is yet another character named Captain Marvel that is not part of the Big Two, as you can imagine by the fact that I've never had to clarify that I'm not talking about him. He didn't really go very far, and unfortunately failed in that lawsuit. His daughter once conveyed an anecdote of him burning all his remaining comic book art, original Golden Age material, possibly because of a comic that had just come out featuring the Johnny Storm Human Torch taking on Burgos' character. In later life, Burgos distanced himself from the industry and advised others not to get into it. It's sadly part of a long line of companies screwing over their creators, Marvel in particular, and this is a case of them not reacting well to people wanting to get their fair due for creating such long-lasting and popular characters. But while the original Human Torch may not be as popular as his later namesake, let's dig into Marvel Comics number one and salute one of the forebears of the Marvel Universe. So because it's actually about the Human Torch, we can properly talk about the cover, which is fine enough, although a bit misleading. The Human Torch appears to be some kind of demonic goblin melting away a massive steel door while someone with fish lips fruitlessly tries to shoot at him from point-blank range. He's also got a grenade, which, yeah, unless it's a flashbang, I don't see it doing much.
You fool!
Action, mystery, adventure, immolation. Being a Golden Age anthology comic, we don't really have time for your single splash page preview things. Instead, we've got the logo and the Human Torch coming through a wall, making sure to give the thumbs up to property destruction. We open on a scientist meeting with some reporters.
Gentlemen of the press, I called you to my laboratory because I, Professor Horton, have a difficult problem in my latest discovery. I've invented Tupperware that will keep food fresh for years on end! But it also leaps onto your face and tries to tear it off. As you all know, I've been working on a synthetic man, an exact replica of a human being. I call it Logan Paul.
Gotta love any discussion that begins with, as you all know. Nothing is more natural sounding than telling people things they're already aware of, And I don't even get why it needed to be included. It's a scientist announcing a major thing. Why did it need to exposit? Oh yeah, these reporters all knew I was building a robot. He leads the reporters to his creation, held in a glass tube.
In this airtight glass cage lives my creation. I call him the Human Torch, even though he is, by definition, not actually human. But hey, I own the trademark already, so there you go. Something went wrong with my figuring somewhere. Every time this robot, the Human Torch, contacts oxygen in the air, he bursts into flame.
Something went wrong with your figurings? That's like saying I was doing some algebra and forgetting to carry the one caused the 10-car pileup. I think we're missing a few steps in between here. Also, gotta love how he explicitly reminded them that the Human Torch is a robot. He lets some air into the cage to demonstrate, and indeed, the torch bursts into flames. The reporters are horrified.
Horton, destroy that man before some madman can grasp its principles and hurl it against our civilization.
Our civilization doesn't know how to stop fire! But yeah, he refuses to destroy his creation, despite the warning about what evildoers could do with it. You know, when you get right down to it, this is basically the plot of Neutro. Also, why did he call reporters here and not, you know, other scientists? And in fact, the reporters write a story about it, and it attracts the attention of other scientists who want to take a look at the torch. The spontaneous fire is so hot that it actually breaks the meter, which means, man, that must be some strong-ass glass if it's not melting. The scientists agree that the Human Torch should probably be dismantled since he can't control the flames. Professor Horton asks if there's any way they can control the—
Good God, man! What's wrong with your head? You look like one of the Metalunans from This Island Earth!
I'm not an alien!
Another scientist comes up with an idea. Seal the android in a concrete block. That way, there'll be no danger of him setting anything on fire, plus it'll buy them time to figure out a permanent solution. And thus they do it, putting the Human Torch in an airtight steel tube, then dumping that in a massive block of concrete.
Time went by, and everybody had forgotten about the fireman. Until one early morning, there was a terrifying blast, and the earth split open. The explosion had nothing at all to do with him, but it did remind everyone that he existed.
Horton hears a "Oh God, no," and wonders if somehow the torch escaped, speculating that somehow there had been a leak in the chamber, though he writes that possibility off.
But there had been a leak. A slow leak, allowing the oxygen to seep in slowly.
From where? How porous was this concrete if it was letting air go through it? The Human Torch starts running around, knocking people away with his fire, and even destroying some power lines.
I'm burning alive. Why must everything I touch turn to flame?
I better keep running around touching things to see if it's still happening. He does finally stop when he spots some approaching firefighters, who try to douse him with water, and unfortunately, it just tickles him. He also somehow steps on the fire hose, burning through it until the water isn't shooting out of the hose anymore, and he resumes running.
The flames once again shoot up, and the Human Torch is on the loose again.
This is a weird update to the Gingerbread Man fairy tale. Trying to find a spot to retreat, he spots a pool and leaps into it, because I guess Horton made sure to waterproof the thing that spontaneously bursts into flames. The owner of the estate, named Sardo, and his henchman Red realize the torch is in the pool and seal it up with a glass cover, usually used for winter. They drain the pool of water as well as air, leaving him in it as Sardo hits upon a scheme. He's gonna do an insurance racket. Threaten businesses to buy his fire insurance, or they'll burn down, starting with a warehouse full of steel.
But steel can't boil! Look, dope, that guy in the pool is the Human Torch, and he can melt steel!
9/11 conspiracy theorists love the Human Torch. He threatens the warehouse owner, who refuses to budge, and thus Sardo begins his extraordinarily convoluted racketeering scheme, which involves getting a glass case for the Human Torch, who thinks Sardo is helping him, putting him inside of it underwater while wearing a diving suit, transporting the Human Torch to the warehouse, breaking into the warehouse, and then smashing open the protective glass and letting the Human Torch just walk around. Even the Human Torch is confused by this, though admittedly it's because of his misunderstanding of Sardo's motives. I wonder if he might be just a low-down racketeer. It's a good thing Horton made sure to program the Human Torch with a sense of ethics and moral outrage over racketeering. Tell me, did he do that before or after the android started bursting into flames? Realizing that this is indeed the reason why he's here, he escapes the burning building and leaps high into the air.
Even the Human Torch is surprised as his leap turns out to be a flight through space.
Able to leap tall buildings in a single bound? Ha! Excuse me while I kiss the sky, Clark!
The reason was that the blue and combined red flames made the Human Torch lighter than air.
Of course! Don't you know anything about science?
After landing, the Torch returns to Sardo's house, where he locks himself in. Naturally, the Torch easily burns his way through while the Crook makes his way down into his secret underground lab, because I guess you just have those when you're a criminal in the 30s.
Which is also surrounded by 12-inch battleship chromium steel plates. Seems like the dude was already a successful criminal. Don't see why he needed new, overcomplicated schemes involving the Human Torch. As the Human Torch destroys the house, he searches for Sardo without success.
Ha ha ha! It was easy to burn Sardo's home down!
I've got it! Arson!
The Torch goes after the henchmen next. And murders them, because this is the Golden Age and we don't care. Locating Sardo's lab, the Torch is easily able to burn through the door. Sardo starts throwing stuff at the Torch to try to slow him down. A gas grenade, a tank of liquidar, whatever the hell that is. But the attention of both is taken by the sound of a fire engine arriving. Horton is with the firefighters, and he spots a tank full of nitrogen, intent on stopping it before it explodes, but the Human Torch gets to it first. I guess the lab isn't that underground. The gas covering him. For whatever reason, the nitrogen puts out the flames on him. However, the fire chief is nearby and pulls out a gun.
This'll be a better world without you, Mr. Torch!
Oh, please. My father was Mr. Torch. Call me Hugh. He shoots, but the bullet just melts as soon as it hits his forehead. Gotta love this face, too. That is a meme-worthy reaction face right there. Remembering Sardo, the Torch heads back down to the lab. The Crook realizes that the nitrogen must have somehow doused his flames, but it soon wears off and he returns to his previous state. Sardo tries to bargain with more nitrogen, but the Torch isn't having any of it. However, he takes that as a cue to just start wrecking the lab. As one final shot to kill him, Sardo tries to hurl some sulfuric acid at him, but it explodes before it can get close, the blast killing the criminal.
Poor fool. Killed by his own hand. That fool. Why didn't he let me kill him?
The Torch takes the nitrogen out and experiments with it on himself. Somehow this allows him to consciously control and suppress the flames, even throw fireballs. Later, the cops come up to him, but he demonstrates that he can now stop himself, even surrendering himself to them. He explains the entire situation to them, and the cops remand custody of the Torch over to Horton, who upon learning of his ability to control the flame, exclaims that he can use the Human Torch to get a fortune.
So, even you've been touched by the possibility of a fortune in me, eh, Horton? No, Horton. I'll be free, and no one will ever use me for selfish gain or crime. Nope, no siree. Nobody will ever use me for evil intent or destroying cities full of people or attacking other heroes or anything like that in the next 80 years.
And so our comic ends with the Torch leaping out of the lab's roof, no doubt causing even more damage after being a dick to his creator just because, you know, he feels he should actually earn some money with his amazing abilities. This origin is pretty good for the most part. The Human Torch is considered the very first Marvel superhero. And what's funny is that this origin kind of reflects that. A lot of Marvel heroes have that whole hated and feared thing going for them, and that can be the case for the Torch, who didn't mean to cause so much destruction and fear, but did so regardless. While the issue kind of wraps that up fairly neatly, it's a good storytelling engine of him trying to show off that he's a hero, but many of the populace distrusts him. Works for Spider-Man, at least. The complaints I do have about the book are fairly minor. Some artistic fails, even for the time. The convoluted nature of Sardo's plan, but honestly, none of that is too distracting from an otherwise enjoyable origin. I especially appreciate from an artistic standpoint how efficient the comic is, with a lot of panels per page. Compressed storytelling was the watchword during this time, but the amount of panels allows for a decent pace for the story, and everything flows nicely. The Torch would eventually adopt the civilian moniker of Jim Hammond, joining the police department, and even eventually gaining a sidekick nicknamed Toro. Later stories would see the Torch team up with Namor, Captain America, and Bucky to fight the Nazis in World War II. He's been dead a few times, either losing power or blown up trying to save others. He's also sadly had to face a few retcons, from the belief that Ultron used his components to make Vision to actually having his personal timeline split to create Vision, or maybe Vision was made from some other android Professor Horton created. You get the idea. It's a shame he's kind of overshadowed by Johnny Storm, since he's a good character with plenty of potential, just needs the right kind of push to show him as a heavy hitter in the Marvel Universe, especially given his status as their first superhero. Next time, we jump ahead to our first ever Bronze Age origin story, with that guy who's the best there is at what he does. When I finished, I found I had surpassed anything that any scientists had ever done. Suck it, Einstein! I invented a robot that's always on fire!